The HU1000 V2 from Hi-Fi Man. These were sent in to me by Talbot Hound, thank you very much. And I'm going to do this review slightly differently than I normally would. So normally I just talk about the headphone. I talk about what I think of it, how it sounds, what I think it's good for, not good for. I'm actually going to talk about this one both alone and quite extensively in comparison to the Hi-Fi Man Aria. Two reasons for that. One is that these are quite similar headphones, obviously both from the same manufacturer, same product line. And also because whilst I love these, I think these are fantastic. As a reviewer, it's not just my job or intention to talk about what I think of a product, but to let you know that if I think there's something better for your money, to tell you about that. And I think that for a lot of people, actually the Aria is going to be a better choice. I'll explain why, but let's talk about the build of this first. So, most obvious thing, during this review, if you see this flapping about, just know that that is not indicative of how this headphone is going to arrive to you. This is an older unit. The person that sent it to me bought it used himself, and it was like this when he got it. If you store these headphones on the desk, this gets pushed up. So imagine if you don't store these properly over time, this might get a bit floppy. You can buy that part on its own, though. And I should also mention, actually, my experience with Hi-Fi Man customer support has been amazing. I had a slight issue with one of my headphones. It was really quite minor. And I emailed them and I just said, hey, what is the best way to deal with this? And they said, oh, we'll just ship it here. We'll send you new headphones. And they did. No questions asked other than literally, hey, just show us an invoice. That was it. Headphones fixed or new headphones. So even if you did have some kind of problem with your headphones, I have no doubt that Hi-Fi Man would sort you out. The rest of the build, though, is fantastic. It looks gorgeous. These pads, angled, by the way, just the right amount of give. They look great on the inside and outside. The build is this lovely brushed metal finish with the driver semi-exposed. It's a fantastic-looking headphone. It's quite clear that this is veneer. This does not look like real wood, but it's still very premium-looking. There's no glue or a seam or anything. It looks fantastic. It really, really does. Again, that's just on this unit. Normally that would stay quite up. My Arias, for example, I've had those for 2 years. Still sturdy. My Cesvara doesn't have the problem either. The only thing I really don't like is the cable. I don't know why this is such a common theme for high-end headphone manufacturers to have god-awful cables, but people will say, hey, doesn't matter. Cables don't change. Cables don't have a sound. This one does. Listen. When I first got my Cesvara, which uses the same cable, by the way, I thought I had a driver problem because when I turned my head, I could hear that crinkling. Turns out it's just the cable because this crinkles. It's got this weird rubber IV tube type thing with the metal materials going through it, and they just rub against each other freely. It's then pretty microphonic, so that just gets transferred straight up to the headphones, and it sounds like crinkling. Would really recommend getting a custom cable if you're going to get these. This one, for example, it was done by Skedra. I will leave a link to his stuff in the description. That man has magic hands. This one's even starting to oxidize. Like, you can see that one's going a little bit green there. So God knows what's going on. It uses, on this model, a 2.5mm connection. Newer ones will have 3.5. Everything on Hi-Fi Man, including Cesvara, HU1000, V2, SE, etc., is all moving to 3.5mm. So new units will be 3.5. If you're buying used, it could be either. But you're not here to hear me talk about how it looks, how it sounds. I will mention, though, oh my god, these are comfy. The HU1000 line, I'm happy to say, is the most comfortable line of headphones I've tried. The Aria, I actually use as my sort of daily driver at PC headphone, just because they're so comfortable. These are an all-plastic construction, or mostly plastic. So they're a lot lighter than these. A little bit lighter. That makes them a little bit more comfy, and a little bit more comfy than Cesvara. A lot of people are going to prefer, though, the all-metal construction of the HU1000 V2 to the Aria, which is completely understandable. But absolutely, these are the most comfortable headphones I've tried. HD800 are plenty comfy. These are comfier. Right, let's talk about how they sound. And let's start with treble. The treble on these is beautiful. Let's use something with quite a lot going on. Caritas by DEADMAU5. Thank you. this is stunning. This is big. This is so clearly, distinctly separate. It's not just that there's a group of violins going off over here. You can hear every single individual one and focus on it with really no effort. It's stunning. The difference, though, between this and Aria depends on the chain. I'll talk a little bit about that more at the end, actually. Let's just focus on these for now. So, treble is fantastic. The staging is very wide. It's really well layered. One of the things that these do splendidly is layering. The difference between something that is this direction and here versus that direction and over there is clear as day. Separation, layering, staging, and spatial presentation overall is beautiful, with the slight exception that front staging could be better. There's a lot of times, not on this track, but with vocals, let's pick something to demonstrate that, where I would want it to be a little bit further out. So if we go Fallen From Your Arms by Bob Moses. It's very airy, it's very timbrally accurate. It sounds realistic, but it's a bit close, that's all. And so that can give a bit of an in-your-head kind of feeling to some vocals. Arias don't tend to have that. They do stage out front just a bit better. It's not a huge difference, and they kind of scoop at the front soundstage, but these, it's a lot more close in. Treble overall, though, is fantastic, and it's very sweet. One of the problems that a lot of people have with some of the lower-end Hi-Fi Man stuff, and with the Aria as well, is that the treble can be a little bit much. It can be a little bit forward, a little bit bright. These don't have that. In fact, probably the biggest difference between these and the Arias is the treble. Arias are slightly more detailed. Arias are slightly more separate. If we go back to Caritas and we play the same song on both... swap to Arias. Leaving the volume the same, because these are same sensitivity and everything. It's just a bit bigger, a little bit more resolving, but not quite as warm. These are a slightly warmer sounding headphone. These are very sweet and romantic, whereas the Aria is a little bit more neutral with a slightly forward treble. That's great because it means detail isn't exactly related to frequency response. These are slightly more resolving than the AT1000 V2, in my opinion, not just because they're more forward, but actually from a technical standpoint. But then they are a little bit less forgiving. On something like this, it doesn't matter because the track is fantastic. But on something where there is sibilance, these just take the edge off. Whereas the Aria will just pass it through, and if the track's bad or your source is bad, you're going to have a bad time. Whereas these will go, hey, look, there's a little bit of a problem here, but I'm going to let you enjoy your music. That's something I really like about these. They are smooth without being smoothed over. They are forgiving without being veiled. Very nice. Let's talk about mid-range. Mid-range on the HD1000 V1 was very well regarded. In fact, it was a headphone which people would buy specifically for the mid-range. From terms of timbre, it was apparently one of the best. I can't compare directly to the V1 because I've not heard it, but this sounds fantastic. In terms of timbre, mid-range, tonality, it's brilliant. One thing I would like to clear up, though, timbre is not warmth. Warmth and timbre are actually kind of unrelated. Timbre doesn't mean that it's not harsh and that it's forgiving and that it's smooth and engaging. It means that it sounds realistic. It means that something sounds close to what it sounds like in real life. There's plenty of headphones where it's warm and it's thick and it's engaging and it's fun, but it's not realistic. And there's a lot of headphones which go the other way. There's a lot of headphones which are very bright, very forward, very detailed and extremely resolving, but don't sound realistic at all. I had a pair of Stax Lambda Signatures. It's a vintage Stax model. I think it's still the thinnest driver that Stax ever made. Most resolving headphones I've ever heard, but they don't sound realistic at all. It sounded very, very fake and plasticky. So, let's talk about mid-range. Let's find something with good vocals. Let's do that. Oh, we got to do Bob Moses. Bob Moses stuff is just too good. Stealing Fire. Oh, yeah. Oh, there's a lot going on here, which is nice. The guitars, just slightly behind me, the vocals on either side, there's none in the center on this track. It's just stunning. It's just the right amount of forwardness without sounding forced. It's just the right amount of smooth without being smoothed over or veiled. And it's positioned properly. It's fantastic. Mid-range on these headphones is probably my favorite thing about them. Let's do some Daft Punk. We've got Horizon. This was only released in Japan, but it's damn good. There's not really all that much I can do to describe the mid-range, just because it sounds amazing. There's very few headphones I've heard which do mid-range better from a natural presentation type perspective. There are some which are perhaps more vivid, something like a ZMF Verite Closed. That is a fantastic headphone. It gives you a very colored presentation. It's like if someone took a picture and turned the contrast up. It's way more vivid and colorful than real life, but it's beautiful. Love the Verite Closed. But this is, in terms of how natural it is, it's fantastic. It's beautiful, it's stunning, nothing wrong with it at all, and there's not really much more I can say. This track, though, leads me on to Low End. Low End timbre is excellent. In terms of how realistic things sound, it's brilliant. This is an interesting track. Now, the reason I picked this was because it shows off how good these headphones are at positioning low end. A lot of headphones, you get nice low end, fast, snappy, textured, whatever, but it's kind of in your head. It's compressing to make it slammy. These don't do that. These can position drums wherever they're supposed to be. That's fantastic. Getting those gorgeous vocals in again. But the other thing it's showing off is that the low end is just a touch soft. The drums in this, for example, sound very convincing, very realistic. But they could be just a bit snappier, a little bit faster. And that's actually another thing which is very different on these versus the Arias. So if I play a little bit on this, and then we swap back to the Arias. The Arias, they need more power to get the low end right, but if you give them that power, they do it slightly better. The drums are just a little bit snappier. The presentation overall is a little bit warmer on the HE1000 V2, but in terms of timbre, I've got to hand it to the V2. It's slightly better, but in terms of speed, detail alone, because detail and timbre aren't necessarily related, I've got to give it to the Aria. These are very similar headphones. They do a lot of things very, very similarly. They sound very similar in a lot of ways, but then there's just subtle differences that make them better for certain genres. I think the Arias are slightly better all-rounder. The biggest problem, though, is that the Aria is a lot more picky in terms of source chain. This is not very picky at all. You can make this sound good on anything. So let's talk about that. Normally with planars, planars don't really slam or sound good in terms of the low end unless you give them a lot of juice. Even lower sensitive or higher sensitivity cans, HE400, or even the Aria. Aria isn't that hard to drive, but the low end changes massively depending on what you put it on. You can get them plenty loud on a JDS Atom, on an ADI2, on an AHP2, obviously, and the low end changes each time. Whereas these, it sounds mostly the same. This is a 1.5 watt head amp. And then we put them on the AHP2. That sounds better just because it's a better source chain, way better DAC, way better amp, but it's not massive. Whereas the Arias, that's a pretty big jump. The arias need a little bit of warmth, a little bit of life injected into them, otherwise they can sound a little bit clinical. But if you give them that, they sound better, but it can take a bit to get them there. So let's put these on the ADI-2. I don't even need to listen anymore. That it just immediately sounds a lot flatter. It's a lot less engaging. It's a lot more 2D in terms of the presentation as well. It's not staging as well. And then we go onto the AHB2. We have life. Now there is space, there is life, there is fun. These benefit a lot from power. These do, but not as much. Nowhere near as much, in fact. And so, I love both of these. I think both of these are stellar headphones. But the big problem is that these cost half of what these do. And so, it's pretty tough to justify these. I think that from a timbre perspective, they're a bit better. But in terms of staging, detail, and low end, these are a little bit better. The only thing is that you have to have a good source chain. These will sound good on anything. These don't sound good on cold stuff. These don't sound good on an ADI-2. These don't sound that good on a 789. You need something good. You need an Asgard 3. You need an AHB2. You need a PHA-1. I'll probably do those pretty well. That sometimes has a bit of trouble with planars, but it's a good amp. These are beautiful headphones. But when they're twice the cost of their little brother and their little brother's doing almost everything just as well and something slightly better, I can't say that it's not worth getting these instead. And so that's kind of my conclusion. These headphones alone, I think they have absolutely fantastic spatial presentation, with the exception that I wish the frontal staging was just a bit better. I think that the texture of the treble and the mid-range is fantastic. You will never find these harsh or fatiguing. Sibilance is never an issue on these headphones, but they don't sound smoothed over. Mid-range is beautiful. Mid-range is convincing. Vocals sound fantastic. Strings sound fantastic. There's not really anything which sounds bad on these at all. Low-end timbre is, again, really good. Drums sound fantastic. Drums sound brilliant. Bass guitar is lovely. These are a little bit more present in the low-end than the arias, but then these don't quite have as much slam. You put these on for an EDM or something and you're going, I want to be smacked a little bit. Just for the conclusion, let's pop another track on. Working for it. Here we go. You've been working here all night long. Let me see if I can give you back. That sounds good, but again, I'm just not getting the slam. I'm not being punched in the chest when I want to be. That's what I want for this song. I want it to be a little over the top. And these are slightly better. If you're a bass head, you're not buying either of those cans. If you are a bass head and you're just listening to EDM stuff, look at an LCDX. LCDX is probably a better choice. If you're listening to a lot of acoustic music, one of these is going to suit you better. If you've got a lot more cash to spend and you have a colder source chain, or you only listen to what I would describe as softer music, and timbre is your priority, these are slightly better. If you want absolute resolution and detail, and you do occasionally listen to electronic music, and you want a little bit more engagement and slam in the low end, the arias are better. But just know that you will need a better source chain. You will need a beefier amp, one that isn't particularly sterile, if possible. So I think these are great, but I think that Hi-Fi Man potentially made a slight mistake in terms of the pricing. A huge thank you once again to Talbot Hound for sending these in for review, and a huge thank you as well to all of my patrons, especially my Diamond and Legend tier patrons, Lana Bennett, Daniel Mellinger, King Jung-un, Ross Kyle, and Chris. You guys are fantastic. If you'd like to join me on Discord, you can do so at the link in the description, links to Patreon and Subscribestar as well. We also have a private Telegram chat where we talk about audio stuff all day long. Hope you enjoyed this. Thank you very much. Have a great day.